every British band since the Beatles has seen going mainstream in America as a measure of supreme success. But rarely does that happen. It's a big place, and just because something appeals to UK taste, doesn't mean it'll definitely cross over. Some of the greatest British acts of all time haven't made a dent in the US. Cliff Richard, The Kinks, The Jam, The Stone Roses, Blur, and The Libertines, all household names in Britain, but barely known in the US.
We're Arctic Monkeys, this is I Bet You Look Good on the Dance Floor. Don't believe the hype.
Arctic Monkeys were a band that seemed destined for this lack of US appreciation. A Sheffield guitar band beloved in the UK, whose singers' insightful lyricism followed a British songwriting tradition, passed down from the Kinks Ray Davies through Paul Weller, Morrissey, and Pulp's Jarvis Cocker. This quintessential British view on nights out, relationships, and not very good local bands ran through their 2006 debut. But references to Rotherham, the phrase Mardy Bum, and frontman Alex Turner's thick Yorkshire accent were not going to translate internationally. But then 7 years later, they beefed up their sound, slowed down, and made the US Billboard Top 10 with Do I Wanna Know. This is New British Canon, and here's the story of how the Arctic Monkeys broke America. Arctic Monkeys formed in Sheffield in the early 2000s, composed of guitarist-vocalist Alex Turner, guitarist Jamie Cook, drummer Matt Helders, and bassist Andy Nicholson. Previous to starting the band, none of their members had played an instrument before, but called to action by the retro rock and roll of The Strokes and their landmark Is This It album, they started a band. Their initial sound was an energetic British spin on that. With Turner's intricate and rapidly delivered lyrics inspired by the flows of the Wu-Tang Clan and punk poet John Cooper Clarke.
Bloody train is bloody late, your bloody way, bloody lost and bloody found, stuck in fucking chicken town.
Through MySpace, their demos gained them a sizable following, and they signed to London-based indie label, Domino. This early hype got their first single, 2005's I Bet You Look Good on the Dance Floor, straight to number one in the UK charts.
Well, I bet that you look good on the dance floor. I don't know if you're looking for romance or...
Then, in January 2006, their debut album, Whatever People Say I Am, That's What I'm Not, overtook Oasis and Elastica to become the fastest-selling debut album in the UK. The week it was released, Enemy writers voted it the fifth best British album of all time, beating London Calling and Revolver. Despite being a very big deal in the UK, their appeal in the US was limited. This was not helped by the band not wanting to do press, award shows, and the usual promotional ephemera.
Come on, be excited. It's supposed to be like the next big thing.
Well, it's supposed to be, but probably aren't.
In an interview with Rolling Stone in 2013, Cook and Helders defended their unwillingness to play the game. But we were teenagers then. Maybe we would have won a Grammy by now if we hadn't been so stubborn. But no regret. Rather than spend time touring America to build their profile, they instead dove straight into album number two, Favorite Worst Nightmare. Around this time, Nicholson left the band to be replaced by Nick O'Malley. Again, it was a British number one album, but with even less attention in the US. For their third album, Humbug, they moved out to Rancho de la Luna in Joshua Tree, California, and with the help from co-producer Queens of the Stone Age's Josh Homme, the band were able to really lean into a slower, sludgier version of their sound. This can be heard on the album's lead single, Crying Lightning. About Homme, Turner stated, "He's got a charm. He can persuade you to do things. We'd never done slow, heavy rock songs. It was a different world to us. I don't know if we'd have gone there if it hadn't been for Josh. He used to tell us, it's harder to play slow." After their Pixies-indebted fourth album, 2011 Suck It and See, during spring 2012, Arctic Monkeys supported the Black Keys on their El Camino tour. But beforehand, they recorded something new so they'd have some fresh material, namely the standalone single, Are You Mine?
Well, are you mine?
based on a riff that O'Malley had written. The track went harder than anything they'd previously recorded. While its lyricism and flow was influenced by modern hip-hop. Lil Wayne and Drake. We've been listening to a lot of their stuff recently. I like that thing they do where they talk about something backwards. So they talk about it, and then they say what it actually is in the next line. So I say, I'm up a bit on a string, just before mentioning Tracy Island. But it turned out Are You Mine was just a warm-up for what would feature on their next album. As the Black Keys tour was their first they'd ever done where they weren't the headliner, the band quickly learned they needed to up their game in a live setting. Just playing their songs with teenaged energy wasn't gonna win over a disinterested US crowd. Due to this, Turner's stage persona evolved, moving further from the shy Sheffield lad of 2006 with his guitar up to his chest, and into a definite rock star with swagger, a killer teddy boy hairdo, and actual slick attire. Also by this time, three of the Arctic Monkeys were living in LA, riding motorcycles and dating models, but they needed more songs that reflected this change, that strutted rather than ramshackled. Bassist O'Malley bluntly recalled the band wanted to avoid the same old indie bullshit. Written early in their new album sessions back at Rancho de la Luna with co-producer Ross Orton, Do I Wanna Know was the first moment that achieved this. Have you got color in your cheeks? I guess we turned a corner with Do I Wanna Know. We had this idea for a record where you take the compositional perspective of an R&B producer and apply that to a four-piece rock and roll band, manipulating our instruments to make building blocks for the songs in a way I would imagine Timbaland constructs music. This building block approach of recording Do I Wanna Know began with the recording of the backbeat, a mixture of drums, hand claps, and foot stomps, before fleshing out the rest of the song. The influence from Timbaland is also present on the backing vocals, i.e. O'Malley and Helders, or as Turner referred to them in the AM press tour, the Space Choir Boys. On the track, rather than shouty call and response backups present on older tracks, their vocals are R&B velvet smooth, adopting an almost falsetto while dipping in and out of the mix for emphasis, similar to the vocals in Timbaland's work with Aaliyah. People like Aaliyah, there's real craft on those singles. We like the scales and the melodies on some of those records, the way the backing vocals might come right to the front and disappear again. But the Space Choir Boys were almost not present on the recorded version of the song. LA band Haim were originally asked if they would sing on the track, but due to them being deep in the process of concocting their own brand of hard rock flecked R&B on their debut, Days Are Gone, they had to decline. Said Esty Haim, "We didn't have enough time to come in and learn the harmonies. It would have taken a couple of days. That would have been our biggest dream come true, to sing on an Arctic Monkeys record. It was one of the most painful calls to say no. Maybe the worst day of my life." Along with Timbaland, the band have also stated the importance of the beats and bass on Dr. Dre's 2001 album. Still doing that shit, Andre? Oh, for sure. As well as the rock elements of Ziggy era David Bowie. Don't fake it, baby. The central riff on Do I Wanna Know was written and recorded by Turner on a 12-string Vox Starstream, which gives the lumbering, almost Sabbath-like riff a fuller, meatier sound. Said longtime Arctic Monkeys producer James Ford, "I think he actually bought it as a bit of a joke, but I think it actually turned into a bit of an inspirational instrument. A lot of the riffs on AM were written on that particular guitar." So have you got the goods? Despite a sonic shift for the band, at its core, lyrically, there was limited evolution. Since the beginning, Turner's mind has rarely strayed from writing about the women he loves, lusts, and longs after. When questioned about this by Esquire, he stated, "I write about women, yes. I haven't found a way around it yet. There are other things I eventually might get round to writing about. In a sense, they're about girls, but in a sense, they're about loneliness and longing." Do I Wanna Know continues this trend, its title questioning whether to continue pining over an ex-partner and the emotional uncertainty involved, mirroring the similarly unsure Are You Mine? Pitchfork writer Larry Fitzmaurice compared the song to Drake's Marvin's Room, another track where the protagonist is longing after an ex-partner, and so he, intoxicated, calls her to try and get answers. Just saying you could do better. Turner retorted, because his tune's about getting drunk and calling his old bird. I'm sure Drake and I aren't the only people to have done that though. Those reflections, especially when shit-faced, about what could have been, and the grey area between longing and lusting after a memory, are fertile ground for pop music, as it is such a universal experience. One thing that especially UK fans feared, now that Turner was a resident of LA instead of his native Sheffield, is that his iconic accent would escape him, while nowhere near the syllable-chewing delight of tracks like From the Ritz to the Rubble. Do I Wanna Know still momentarily throws back to where he came from in the song's first verse. The tide that sticks around like summer in your teeth. Proving that you can take the man out of Yorkshire, but you can't take Yorkshire out of the man. Most covers of the track change it to the less regional something. The type that sticks around like something in your teeth. The type that sticks around like something in your teeth. Aside from Dua Lipa, who commits to the dialect word. The type that sticks around like something's
in your teeth. That rock and roll, eh?
Do I Wanna Know secured its place in the British rock pantheon when Arctic Monkeys headlined Friday night at Glastonbury 2013. At this point, the song had barely been released a fortnight, but in an act of sheer arrogance, the band opened with it. A field of onlookers chanted the riff back in unison, a ritual that would continue for each future live appearance. Beyond being a now eternal football chant, the riff was placed at number 3 of Guitar World's best guitar riffs of the decade. Now here's a lesson in how space can make a riff pop, and heck, give it a sense of the profound. Do I Wanna Know also became the Arctic Monkeys' biggest hit in the UK since 2007's Fluorescent Adolescent, peaking out at number 11 in the singles chart. But as a bigger achievement, the single reached the top of the US Billboard Alternative Charts and remained on the chart for 48 weeks. Their previous entry on the Alternative Charts, I Bet You Look Good on the Dance Floor, had only managed to reach number 7 in 2006. And while their greater focus on publicity didn't win them a Grammy, in 2015, Do I Wanna Know was at least nominated for Best Rock Performance. The song's parent album, AM, arrived in September 2013. With its release, Arctic Monkeys became the first ever independently released group to score 5 consecutive UK number 1 albums. In the US, it became their proper breakthrough, reaching the top 10 of the Billboard charts. Finally, the Arctic Monkeys had broken America, but they did much more than that. With Do I Wanna Know, they signaled that rock music wasn't dead. The crowning ceremony in British popular music, the Brit Awards, greeted them with praise. Similar to every other year that the Arctic Monkeys had released music, they had had a fractious relationship with the award show, having not attended and got We Are Scientists' Keith Murray to say a few words when they won Best Breakthrough Act in 2006, then varyingly accepted the accolades dressed as the Village People, the cast of The Wizard of Oz, and some Yorkshire farmers. 2014 was no different. When collecting the prize for Best British Album for AM, Turner delivered the following speech, edited for length and clarity.
That rock and roll, it just won't go away. Might hibernate from time to time and sink back into the swamp. But it's always waiting there just around the corner, ready to make its way back through the sludge and smash through the glass ceiling, looking better than ever. Yeah, that rock and roll, it seems like it's fading away sometimes. It will never die. And there's nothing you can do about it.
In 2014, Arctic Monkeys seemed like the last rock band standing. For Best British Band, which they also won, they are up against the electronic-focused likes of Bastille and Disclosure, as well as One Direction. Not a single loud, distorted guitar between them. As arrogant and or drunk as he may have seemed, Alex Turner was pointing out something that became more obvious as the decade wore on. The rock music isn't as prevalent as it once was. Arctic Monkeys' Do I Wanna Know is proof that guitar-based music can exist and be loved in a modern musical climate. It just needs to try something new, challenge itself, and know what makes rock exciting. It's not that hard. Turner chose to write their follow-up, Tranquility Base, Hotel and Casino, solely on a piano, leaving rock behind. But the next wave is just around the corner, ready to make its way through the sludge, looking better than ever. And there's nothing you can do about it. Thanks for watching. What are some of your favorite rock songs of the last decade? Comment down below. While this video was about one of the best British songs of the decade, what was the best British song last year? In the next video, you'll find out. I'd like to shout out last month's top tier patrons, Andy Carlson, DF, Emily Violet Richardson, and She Melrose. Thank you, it really does help, and I'll see you next time.